I am Ștefan Ghenciulescu. I am an architect, a free architect practicing. I'm a researcher, I teach, and I'm editor-in-chief of Zeppelin magazine. Zeppelin, which is an independent architecture publication, print and online, and also a platform for architecture, research on the city, communication, etc. I got involved into publishing quite early on. At the end of the 90s, we were a group of very, very young architects in Bucharest. And we started to write about architecture, to launch an online magazine at one moment. It was very early on. And then participating to different projects and building up a team. And what happened with us was that a couple of us were asked to publish an architecture magazine, but not just to publish it, to coordinate it completely. That means to coordinate the print, to make it, to publish it, but also to finance it, everything. And I joined in 2001, and it was a very nice experience because we had to start it from scratch and to have a very, very, very small investment. Actually, the investment was us and our PCs. So from the first issue, it had to be in the same time produced and financed. And we also went to distribute it with our backpacks. We also talked to the sponsors and so on. Those were heroic times. And I think that's what characterizes us even today. That it's not a very big team, but one that builds up projects little by little. Also the magazine, it got a little bit bigger, then it started to have some color pages, and then it started to have a little bit more issues, and then it started to have the English text and to become a little bit more international, and so on. During about in 2010, we really made the magazine our own and started to publish it as a completely independent publication. And also that we, at some point, we started to build up around it a richer activity. We started by making some exhibitions, some biennales. We won a project in Venice for the Biennale in 2006 and started to make books little by little, conferences and so on. And in 2015, another big change, we turned it into a bookazine, which means that at the same time a book and a magazine. And we turned our previous site into a really free web platform for architecture and the city. It's now a collaborative platform. It's we make a lot of projects. Some of the core team, which is made not only by me, but my two partners, Konstantin and Cosmina, has remained the same. But we work sometimes, we work in a lot of different ways. There are projects that we do alone, that we do in 2, 4, 6, sometimes 20, 30 persons, if it's a bigger event. And what I'm very proud of is that a lot of this activity is not done, not really only coordinated by us or starting from us, but it's also, it has become, we have more and more projects which are completely horizontal, in which we are equal partners with other persons or organizations. And I really like this very, very much. If we come to the character, to the identity of the magazine, we are a little bit like Shrek in the animation. So like ogres, we have lots of layers. So for instance, if I take the magazine, it's a professional one, but it's also a cultural one. And we try to make it a little bit more accessible without destroying and without becoming populists. We think that is very important. So there is a section which is separate, which contains the plans, the details, the more technical stuff. So that even people which are not architects can concentrate and read easier the rest of the articles. And we kind of assume that there are always different types of public, and that some of them will only remain at the level of the pictures. Some may read the legends. Some of them will also read the texts. Some of them will even read the theoretical texts. And then others will enjoy the drawings and learn from them. I think that one of the main characteristics is that we mix a lot and that we try to bring architecture to other people and then to bring the rest of the world into architecture, so to have visions from and opinions from people which not from the architecture community. Another thing is that we believe a lot in smart projects, in projects done with lower budget, in things that have added value as regarding architecture. That is very important to us. And the third thing would be that we like history very much, but we're not a historical magazine. It's not about architectural history, but we like to put today's production in a historical context and also look to older things from a new, fresh perspective. So to bring together sometimes projects that are 100 years apart, but which share a lot of things in common, and which allow us and allow the public to look very differently at each and one of them. About successful article, well, there are several types of them. There's one category that works very well. Actually, two. There are two categories that work very well. And one is about restoration and working with the old. For us, it's a very important topic. And it seems that for a lot of people today also. So sometimes an old building that is rehabilitated in a very nice way, it's rather appreciated than a very beautiful new one. And then I have noticed that projects in the countryside, good projects in the countryside, of course, are very popular. So it seems that this kind of, we still have this kind of very nostalgic and very dreamlike view of the countryside. We're still very interested in it, even if most of us live in the cities. So a project which is in the countryside will have a guaranteed success on the site and also in the magazine. And if you bring these two together, let's say a very beautiful and intelligent rehabilitation and maybe extension of a house in the countryside, that will be a smash. So now it's not a surprise anymore. It's quite something common. And on the other hand, I think that sometimes things that are less successful are maybe like that because people have a bit of problem of realizing from what perspective they are done. It's because we try to so much to get out of this, get out of our architect's box. You have kinds of articles where people don't really know if it's about architecture or it's about the culture in general or the social stuff and where to place you. Where would be the section? And I remember particularly an article I think I wrote 2 years ago, which was about 1.5, 2 years ago, which was about this very beautiful exhibition, Their Mortal Remains, the story of Pink Floyd. And it was very emotional for me, but in the same time, I tried to highlight the architectural character in Pink Floyd, not just their short career as architecture students, but also the way the architecture is part of their work and part of their presentation and part of the concerts and etc. So architecture by sound. And I think that, well, people liked it, but generally they reacted more to the Pink Floyd side and to the nostalgic side and less to maybe what I tried to present there. It's hard because I think that more people like and are interested in architecture than we know, but they're kind of reluctant to enter a discussion and they're very reluctant to get into architectural exhibition or to read an architectural publication. That's extremely clear. I think that if you look at an audience at even a very important architectural exhibition, most of them will be architects, designers and students. And I think the challenge is to let them understand that architecture is actually really a part of culture and also of their life. And that it's not just a thing for specialists, and it's just not about aesthetics, but it's really about how we live and how we could live. And that architects, if they do their job well, are not just the artistic guys that come after the serious work has done, are really not this kind of guy, but are really the persons that are in between everybody, that can understand the different points of view and are not cased into one specialty, and that can bring the people that bring everybody at the table, and that can make people dialogue from very different perspectives, the city, society, the engineers, the client, and so on. And I think that this actually all discussion about how we present architecture and the urban problems should be a discussion also about how our discipline looks today and in what to what respect we are still relevant. And but that being aside, I think it's very much about, well, on the one hand, making this thing a little bit more understood and making people have more courage into talking to us. And on the other hand, it's finding ways of communicating which may be able, in an ideal way, to be accessible and fun and attractive without lowering the value of the content. I could, well, if I could find some cases, I would really like to look to somebody like Tarantino or to somebody like Umberto Eco, two very different personalities, but each and one of them had the capability of producing culture and of talking in various ways about culture and about very important things, while being in the same time extremely accessible and popular and seen as relevant by a variety of people. So if we can find our Echos and our Tarantinos, that would be a very nice thing.